Hello everybody, welcome to this next video on linear algebra. In this video we will look at a test for diagonality of a linear operator when all its eigenvalues are not distinct. So I'll give you the picture where we are right now. So that is a recap. So recap is, we have a linear operator from V to V and we say that this operator is diagonalizable if and only if there is a basis beta of V such that matrix representation of T with respect to that basis is a diagonal matrix. So this is the definition, and we saw that the initial thing which we saw was T is diagonalizable if and only if there is a basis consisting only of eigenvectors of T, right? It means that you should get n linearly independent eigenvectors of T. Then we saw in the last video that when T has n distinct eigenvalues, then you don't have to see whether you get a basis with n eigenvectors or not, because we proved that eigenvectors corresponding to distinct eigenvalues are linearly independent. So whenever T has n distinct eigenvalues, we straight away say that T is diagonalizable. This is what we saw in the last video. But the converse is not true. So it means that, so when suppose you have an operator T, suppose T1 is an operator having eigenvalues say 2, 3, 5, and another is an operator 2, 2, 5. So here, since all the eigenvalues are distinct, we say it is diagonalizable. But here, because all the eigenvalues are not distinct, we cannot use the above result. What to do in this case? When eigenvalues are not distinct. So that is what we are going to answer in this video. So the answer for discussion is in this video. Fine. So let us go and see how we can answer it. So I'll give you a theorem which will answer you this. We say that T from V to V is diagonalizable if and only if, this is a theorem, if and only if the characteristic polynomial of T, looks like F is equal to x minus c1, which is the one eigenvalue, raised to power d1, x minus c2 raised to power d2, x minus c3 raised to power d3, and so on, x minus ck raised to power dk, right? And dimension of di is equal to dimension of eigenspace corresponding to ci. So this is the theorem. Let me explain that we are saying that you should have, you are given an operator T, it will be diagonalizable if and only, first of all, you can factorize its characteristic polynomial. You should have n factors. It means that it has n real eigen values, right? This statement is equivalent to saying that it has n real eigenvalues. They may not be distinct, right? And the repetition, that how many times c1 is repeated, d1 times, then that d1 should be the dimension of the eigenspace corresponding to c1, right? Now this is a statement. The same thing we can write it as this. We have definition, then I'll rewrite the statement. If ci is a root of characteristic equation di times, then we say di is algebraic multiplicity of ci, right? So whenever di, like how many times a characteristic value or an eigenvalue is a root of the characteristic equation, that is the algebraic multiplicity. So here d1 is the algebraic multiplicity of c1, d2 is the algebraic multiplicity of c2, d3 is the algebraic multiplicity of c3, dk is the algebraic multiplicity of ck. Another definition, dimension of the eigenspace of an eigenvalue, say ci, is called the geometric multiplicity of ci. Geometric multiplicity of ci. Right. So here now look at this statement again. So we are saying that t from v to v is diagonalizable if and only if the characteristic polynomial of t looks like this. It means that it has n real eigenvalues or n eigenvalues in your field, whatever field you are talking about. If you are talking about R, then it should have R real eigenvalues. And if you are talking about complex, then you don't have to worry, because always complex is algebraically closed field. Anyway, you will have n roots there, right? So, and further you are saying this algebraic multiplicity is the dimension of the eigenspace, and this is your geometric multiplicity. So, same statement I can rewrite as the above using these two definitions. These two definitions, I can rewrite the above statement as, I can rewrite it as t from v to v, where dimension of v is n, is said to be, not said to be, is diagonalizable if and only if t has n eigenvalues, may not be distinct, right? N eigenvalues from your field, and algebraic multiplicity of each eigenvalue is equal to geometric multiplicity, right? Is that clear? So this is another statement. The same theorem has this statement too. Now this thing may be confusing for some of you, that what do I mean when I say that it has n eigenvalues, right? So let me put a note. So here you see, suppose the characteristic polynomial of t looks like x square plus 1. So characteristic equation is, therefore characteristic equation is x square plus 1 equal to 0. Now you see, if your field is field of real numbers, if your field is field of real numbers, then you see what will happen, then you no roots. So the above theorem is not valid. The above theorem is not applicable, because we are saying that your characteristic equation should have roots, n roots. Above equation is, above theorem cannot be applied. Above theorem is not applicable. And if your field is field of complex numbers, then you get two roots. Then you get x minus iota, x plus iota is equal to 0. So you get two roots, iota and minus iota, right? So you get two roots, and 2 is the dimension you are working on. Therefore, above theorem is applicable. I can give you another example. For example, if you have this polynomial x minus 1, x square plus 1 equal to 0. Again, its roots are x is equal to 1, right? If you are working on real only, right? So again, if you are working on real, if field is R, you have only one real root. You have only one real root. But above theorem says that you should have 3, because you are working on a polynomial of degree 3, means your space dimension is 3. So again the above theorem is not valid. The above theorem is not applicable. Is not applicable. And similarly, if your field is complex here, then you have L lambda is the value of x is 1, which is a complex number, iota minus iota. Every real number can be treated as a complex number. The above theorem is applicable. The above theorem is applicable. Right? Fine. So, let us prove the theorem now. So, let me write down the statement again. Theorem is T is diagonalizable. T from V to V. From V to V, where dimension of V is N, is diagonalizable if and only if it has N characteristic eigenvalues or characteristic values. So they are same words, right? Same names for the eigenvalues, eigenvalues, and algebraic multiplicity of each eigenvalue is equal to its geometric multiplicity. So this is what we have to prove. Okay, so we have to prove it. Right, so in general, you should know that in general, we have this, that algebraic multiplicity is always greater than or equal to geometric multiplicity. Right, so this is your homework, you should prove it. You should prove it. It is a homework that algebraic multiplicity is always greater than or equal to geometric multiplicity. Right, that is very easy to prove, but you can try. Right, so let us come back to the proof of our theorem. So first we will assume that this thing I'll assume that it has n eigenvalues and each eigenvalue has algebraic multiplicity is equal to geometric multiplicity. Then I'll prove that T is diagonalizable. So let T has n eigenvalues, and for each eigenvalue, so here I am saying n eigenvalues, so you can write it if it is confusing, may not be distinct, because if it they are distinct, then we don't have to prove anything, because the last theorem will work. May not be distinct, right? And for each eigenvalue, algebraic multiplicity is equal to geometric multiplicity, right? So let us call it is equal to di. So let c1, c2, ck be the distinct eigenvalues having am is equal to gm is equal to di, right? Now let us call the eigenspace of c1 as w1. Let us call eigenspace of c2 as w2. Let us call eigenspace of c3 as w3, and so on. Eigenspace of ck as wk. Fine. Now you are saying that its dimension is d1, its dimension is d2, its dimension is d3, its dimension is dk. It means that I will get a basis having d1 elements here, having d2 elements here, having d3 elements, dk elements. So I get a basis. Let me call that basis as x11, x12, x13. x1, d1, and here I get a basis x21, x2, these are vectors, right, two in your space V, x2, d2, you understood the notation, this 1 is because we are talking about w1, this 2 superscript is because we are talking about c2, and so on. So another basis I'll get x13, x32, x33, and so on, x3, d3. And here we'll get xk1, xk2, xk3, xkdk. Right. So you get these bases for each eigenspace. So you get these bases for each eigenspace. Fine. Now, what is d1 plus d2 plus dk? What is d1 plus d2 plus dk? Can you tell me? Just pause the video for a minute and think about what is d1 plus d2 plus dk. It should be clear to you. Now you see, D1 is a multiplicity of C1, algebraic multiplicity. That how many times is the root of C1? And D2 is for C2. DK is for CK. And we know that there are n eigenvalues. So the total should be equal to n. Right? It is equal to n because T has n eigenvalues. Right? So therefore, if I collect all the star elements, purple elements, that is, you collect this x11, x12, x1d1, then you have another x21, x22, x2d2, then you have another x31, x32, x3d3, and then so on. At the end, you have xk1, xk2, xkdk. I collect all these, first set, second set, third set, kth set. I make one set with them. Let us call this set as beta. Then this set has n elements. If I collect all star elements, make it beta, then beta has n elements, which is the dimension of my space. Now if I prove that beta is linearly independent, then you see beta has n elements and all the elements are eigenvectors of T. Why? Because here you are talking about eigenspace. So these elements are from eigenspace. So these are eigenvectors corresponding to C1. For C1, these are eigenvectors for C2 and so on. So you get beta is a collection of n eigenvectors. Now if I prove that this is linearly independent, then I get a basis consisting only of the eigenvectors of T. That means T is diagonalizable, right? So you prove that beta is linearly independent. Can you think? It is very easy to prove that beta is linearly independent. You see, these elements xi1, xi2, xidi, they are linearly independent. Why? Because they form the basis for the eigenspace. Because they are the basis. They are the basis elements of eigenspace of Ci. Eigenspace of Ci. And also we know the result. That eigenvectors corresponding to distinct eigenvalues are linearly independent. This result also we know. Now this is the situation that you have x11, x12, x1d1. These are linearly independent among themselves. And then you have another x21, x22, x2d1, d2. These are linearly independent among themselves. Then you have another x31, x32, x3d3. These are linearly independent among themselves. And so on. Right? At the end you have this. xk1, xk2, xkdk, these are linearly independent among themselves. Now if you collect all of them, they may not be the perfect words, but for understanding it is okay. And they are again mutually linearly independent. And this also is linearly independent with this. Why? Because eigenvectors corresponding to distinct eigenvalues are linearly independent. Therefore, beta is linearly independent. Right? So, you get a basis. Hence, you get a basis beta of V consisting only of eigenvectors of T. Therefore, T is diagonalizable. Right. Now, we have to prove if and only. Before going the reverse proof, I want to tell you, can you look at the picture now? What is happening here? You have W1, eigenspace of C1. Right. Have I named them W1? Yes. Now, you have another W2, eigenspace of C2. Right, and then you have WK, eigenspace of C3. And we know that eigenvectors corresponding to different eigenvalues, they are linearly independent. It means that you cannot have an eigenvector here and here common, except the zero vector. So anything which is common between these K subspaces is only zero vector. So you have a picture like this. This is your W1. Suppose this is a zero vector. Then you have W2, nothing else is common. And similarly, you have W3, only this zero vector is common. And so on, there you may have, you should not have anything else common, so it should not touch, right, only zero. So you understand, right, I'm not touching. So this is your WK. So this is the situation. Now what is happening? WK plus W1 plus W2 plus W3 plus WK, because their dimension, you are taking basis from them and that forms a basis for V. So it means that you should have V is actually direct sum of W1, W2 and WK. So this whole, this yellow, if I cover everything, this is your V. You should not have V anything else. Right? So then only T is diagonalizable. So this is a picture. See, in general, what will happen? In general, picture is this, that you have a vector space V, then you have W1, W2, W3, W4, WK, like this. W1, W2, W3, W4, WK. So you have something in V which is not the sum of all these W's, but the diagonalizable picture means when your T is diagonalizable, then your picture should be that your V is only these petals. There is nothing extra. Right. So you have W1, W2, W3, WK and so on. So V is only these petals. Nothing outside. So that is a picture of diagonalizable. Right. So you see, that is what happens for diagonalization, that you want that all the information is, you know, only at diagonal. So these petals will give you one entry at the diagonal. Is that thing clear? Okay. So that is the idea. Now let us prove the other way out. Let us prove that if T is diagonalizable, then T has n eigenvalues, and for each eigenvalue, algebraic multiplicity is geometric multiplicity. So let us prove it. So you assume that T is diagonalizable. Let T is diagonalizable. It means that therefore there exists a basis beta of V consisting only of the eigenvectors of T, say beta is U1, U2, UN, and T beta, matrix representation of T with respect to that beta will be a diagonal matrix.
Let us assume that diagonal matrix is C1, 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 D1 times, because that may repeat. If it is not repeating, then your D1 is 1. Then C2, 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 D2 times, and so on. Then you have CK, 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 DK times. So this is the most general diagonal element which you can, diagonal matrix which you can assume, right? So this is how you are assuming that your diagonal matrix looks. Then characteristic equation of T is the characteristic equation of T beta beta, because we know that is how we find the characteristic equation. Characteristic equation of T beta beta, that is equal to, now you know how to write out the characteristic equation, this diagonal matrix, that will be lambda minus C1, lambda minus C1, lambda minus C1, D1 times. Then you have lambda minus C2, lambda minus C2, lambda minus C2, D2 times, and so on. At the end you have lambda minus CK, lambda minus CK, lambda minus CK, DK times. 0 here, 0 here. Now you take the determinant. Take the determinant, what you will get? You will get a factor, this D1 times. So you get lambda minus C1 raised to power D1. Lambda minus C2 raised to power D2. Lambda minus CK raised to power DK. So therefore there are D1 plus D2 plus DK, which is equal to N eigenvalue. Why this is N? Because that is the, this matrix has dimension n cross n, because we are having this matrix representation from V to V and dimension of V is n. N eigenvalues. Now to prove that algebraic multiplicity is equal to geometric multiplicity. So algebraic multiplicity is D1 for ith eigenvector, eigenvalue, it is Gi. Algebraic multiplicity of Ci is Gi. Now we need to prove that, Di is the dimension of eigenspace of Ci, right? That is the definition of geometric multiplicity. Now let us write down dimension of eigenspace of Ci, means Wi we are talking about. Dimension of Wi is equal to dimension of, you know that eigenspace is also null space of T minus Ci. You have to note this thing. You see, I'll write here. T is an eigenvalue if and only if Tx is equal to Cix. Ci is an eigenvalue if and only if Tx is equal to Cix. If and only if T minus Ciix is equal to 0. If and only if x belongs to null space of T minus Ci. So you have to notice this thing, that this eigenspace of an eigenvector value is null space of T minus that eigenvector into identity map. Now you see, what is this? What is the matrix representation of this operator? Look at this. Okay, so what I am saying, what is the matrix representation of this operator? We will find out this dimension. Now, what is matrix representation of T minus Cii? You see, T has matrix representation C1, C2, C1, 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 D1 times. Then you have C2, 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 D2 times, and so on. Somewhere you have Ci, 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 Di times, and then at the end you have Ck, 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 Dk times. 0 here and 0 here. So this is your matrix representation of T minus Ci into identity. Right? Now what will happen? Ci will be subtracted from all the diagonal elements. So you have this situation. So T minus Cii has the matrix representation as C1 minus Ci, C1 minus Ci, C1 minus Ci. How many times? D1 times. Then you have C2 minus Ci, C2 minus Ci, C2 minus Ci. How many times? D2 times. And at the ith position, you will have 0, 0, 0. How many times? Di times. And at the end, you will have Ck minus Ci, Ck minus Ci, and so on. Ck minus Ci, how many times? Dk times. So it means that, let me write down, T minus Cii is having this matrix representation that somewhere on the diagonal there are zeros. How many zeros? Di zeros. And before that, no zero. And after that, no zero, because Cis are distinct. Is that thing clear? Now I am asking you, what is the dimension of the null space of this operator? So dimension is, what is null space? Null space is all those vectors, n cross n vectors, say x1, x2, xn, to which it takes to 0, 0, 0. That is the definition of null space. So we are looking for, you see, here if you do this matrix here, this matrix, bring it here. So it will be no zeros, then di zeros, and then no zeros again, into this vector x1, x2, xn is equal to 0, 0, 0. Now you tell me what will happen. Here, these will give you, because this is non-zero, you'll get the these elements 0, all these elements 0, and all the end elements also 0. Only in between these, corresponding to these di, they can be non-zero, they are independent. So this vector will satisfy above equation if, let me call these vectors as y1, y2, yd1, di are free, means there is no restriction on them, and all other are zeros. So your null space of T minus Cii looks like, here zeros everywhere, here below also zeros, and in between you have elements y1, y2, yd, which are independent. So you can write it as y1 into that standard element 0001 at the ith position, and so on, right? So this has how many dimensions? Di dimensions. So it has dimension di, right? So we proved that algebraic multiplicity is equal to, this was your geometric multiplicity, right? And this is your algebraic multiplicity. So you prove that algebraic multiplicity is equal to geometric multiplicity. So this is how you prove the theorem, right? And you see how interesting the proof is. It requires so much of analysis of what you have already done. So it is always good to go for proofs at least once if you are doing a course. And it is very, very, very interesting. All you have to do is you have to look at the intricacies. All the intricacies you have to look. And then you have to analyze that, okay, what is happening. And that is, you know, that is an abstract world, which is very interesting if you are doing it from your heart. Okay, thank you for watching this video. In the next video, I am going to do the examples of this theorem, like how we can use this theorem, right? Thank you. Please do.